everybody. Does anybody feel the presence of God in the house? Yeah, okay. Okay, good. Good, 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 good. Yeah, me too. Praise the Lord. I'll get to you in a second, Anthony. Praise the Lord, everybody. Oh, my goodness. Yeah. You know, you come into the house and it's enjoyable. I hope for you to come into the house and to say hello to your friends and to your family. Hopefully you enjoy it, you know, even the new things that God does. You know, you see the new faces and to say hello. It's a great thing. And then you get involved with each other's lives and the details and the new things that God is doing, or perhaps the new things that you wish he would do. And but I ask this of our Heavenly Father. I ask that more than anything else today, that we would be impacted by his presence, his love, and just how great he is to heal us and touch us. Amen, everybody?
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Now you, Anthony. Anthony and Belinda, you know, God bless you. You've come. They drove all the way from Alabama this morning to be here today. It's amazing. I'm around the corner and I can't get here on time. You come from Alabama.
We'll pray about it.
Yeah. And it's been a while, Chad and Corinthia. You know, it's been a while. So remember Chad, our tennis pro. Come on, everybody. Some of you who have retained some of your tennis skills, not my brother, but some of you. But we welcome you, all the guests, Andrea's guests, we welcome you. We're glad you're here. God bless you. God bless you. I had the honor of having a conversation with Thomas and Amy this morning. What a wonderful time we've had together, and the family. Looks like you grew since I last talked to you. Jamie, very good. Very good. God bless you. Glad you came back. Wow. God bless you all, everyone. If I have not called your name, God knows your name, and that's why you're here this morning. Amen?
Amen.
You know, if you have your bulletins, and if you open up your bulletins, as my brother did this morning, you'll notice that inside the bulletins, you'll discover that the title of our conversation today, the title of our conversation today is, can somebody shout it out for me? You came on the right day, everybody. You came on the right day. My brother knows me well. He knows you. This ain't the right day. How to be rich. How to be rich. Okay, everybody, you got your pens? You got your papers? I'm going to give you God talked to me this morning, and he told me there are three simple truths that will cause you to be rich. You ready?
Ready.
You ain't ready. I ain't ready. How to be rich. It's interesting because, you know, in the world or even in the church, perhaps just as much as the church as the world, sometimes there's really no difference. You have a topic like that, you know, how to be rich. You know, sign me up. I don't know. Maybe you'll tell me something I don't know. You know, even with the titles and the series and the, I don't know, the quests for riches, you know, we're even at times willing to pay money for stuff like that, you know? It's like how to be rich. You pay me $10 and I will give you a conference on how to be rich. And the only one who gets rich is me, because I got all your $10. So it works for me, but it didn't work for you. Yeah, sure. You know, we'll listen to that perhaps. Maybe we'll even pay for something like that. You know, but what if the title was, and I know we're in church, so I'll get the holy answer from you, but what if the title was, How to Be Godly? How to Be Godly. Would you pay for that? I ain't paying for that. I'll come for that, but I ain't paying for it. How to be godly. I don't think the draw would be as great, how to be godly. Maybe I can get one answer, maybe one weak amen from anybody. I got a choking answer over here. Can't even get the words out of our mouths. I'm only playing who's ever choking. So how to be rich. The interesting thing is, you know, we're in church, so it's easy to answer these questions. Are we lovers of money? Everybody? No, you're in church. No, I can't even get no in church on a Sunday. Are we lovers of money? You can have it, but are you lovers of money? No, the Bible says. Thank you, Brother Eddie. What does the Bible say? It strictly says the love of money is the root of all evil. And those of you who might have a dollar or two, you always put emphasis on it's the love of money. Money is not evil. It's the love of money, right? Sure. But you see, yeah. But. You know, the love of money shouldn't even exist. You know, greater than that, of course, is the love of God.
Amen.
And I know we're having fun, but the reason why you're here is because you love God. That's why you come to the church house. You come because you love God. You come because you know He is the lover of your soul, and He is the answer to the only answer to some of our questions, right? Amen. But let me read a few parables with you this morning, and let us maybe refocus or regain perspective in regard to riches, because sometimes we lose perspective in regard to riches. Sometimes we do. So if you have your Bibles, you may turn, or maybe Brother Keith can help us. I want to turn to the 12th chapter of the Gospel of Luke, and I want to start off with, let's start off with the parable of the rich fool. And in Luke chapter 12, right here, let us read this parable together, okay? Let us read it together. Scripture says that someone in the crowd said to Jesus, "Teacher, tell my brother to divide the inheritance with me." Mm-hmm. We'll pause there for a second. Jesus replied, Man, like modern day, man, who appointed me a judge or an arbitrator between you? Isn't this interesting that Jesus is confronted with something that we still confront today in regard to inheritance, perhaps? You know, when somebody in our family passes, it seems as if there's a tendency to see who gets the possessions, if there are any, right? I mean, some of these, anybody in the house, anybody, any honest people in the house today? You see, sometimes these arguments still prevail as to, I know we loved our father deeply, but now that in his passing, like, who gets all the good stuff, you know? And sometimes there's a tendency to argue over that, as with Jesus. And Jesus said, I'm not here to settle your quabbles, man. I'm not here to decide who gets money among you. And then he goes on to give him a lesson about riches. Verse 3. Then he said to them, "Watch out. Be on your guard against all kinds of greed." I'm not going to divide the inheritance. He used it as an opportunity. He says, be careful. Watch out for all kinds of greed. Because life does not consist in the abundance of possessions. We could stop there just to regain our focus about what our life is all about, man. It is not about the abundance of our possessions. And although we are brainwashed every time we walk through these doors sometimes, right? Okay, let us continue then. And he told them this parable. The ground of a certain rich man yielded an abundant harvest. He thought to himself, "What shall I do? I have no place to store all of my crops." Then he said, "This is what I'll do. I will tear down my barns and build bigger ones. And there I will store my surplus grain. And I'll say to myself, 'You have plenty of grain laid up for many years. Take life easy, eat, drink, and be merry.'" Little did he know. But God said to him, you fool, this very night your life will be demanded of you, or your soul shall be demanded from you. Then who will get what you have prepared for yourself? This is how it will be with whoever stores up things for themselves. What does it say there at the end, everybody? But is not rich towards God. But is not rich towards God. You know, we talked on Wednesday a little bit about this in regard to, it's a similar thinking that we have today. A lot of our thinking is, and we think it's wise counsel, to always make sure you got enough for tomorrow. Build up your pensions and build up your retirement. Make sure you have enough to retire upon, you know? And if you don't have enough barns, build bigger barns, you know? If you think you're gonna run out in 10 years, then build some bigger barns so you got enough for 20 years, you know? Some of you think you'll live 10 years past retirement. Some of you 20 years past retirement. Some of you are hoping you make it to retirement. But you see, it's a similar thinking process that we have today, because it's a carnal kind of thinking, to make sure you got enough, man. I got enough. Sometimes we're not satisfied with having enough for today. I want to make sure, you there? I want to make sure I got enough for tomorrow. And when you say tomorrow, you want to be secure, you want to be set for your whole life, right?
For a moment in time, I want to close my eyes to all of the needs that exist around me, but I want to make sure I'm set for life. And then once I know that I'm set for life, maybe I will crack one of those eyes open to see how you're doing. Okay, now, do you need a little something? Okay, let me see what I got here. Meanwhile, I got $1 billion in the bank. What can I help you with? And you know, a lot of times our thought is this. Here's a common one, everybody. Everybody's still in the house today. Great. Here's a common one. You know, if I win the lotto, if God should be so good to me. How many of you played this week? Just messing with you. Good, Eddie. One honest man over there. God bless you. I hope you win the lotto just for your honesty. We're in this together, brother. No one else was honest in the house. You're going to win. If God would allow me to win the lotto, then I'm going to give. Then I'll give. Anybody? Anybody ever? I know you don't say it, but has anyone ever heard that? Yeah, yeah. If I win the lotto, then I'll give. Why? You won't give unless you win the lotto? You see? Because really, we're always looking out. It's okay. It's human nature outside of God. We're always looking out for ourselves, as if we exist outside of everybody else. Like my life matters as if it's not a we thing, it's just an I thing. Anybody in the house? Amen. Right, if I have enough, once I'm taken care of, then I'll make sure you're taken care of. Why don't you take care of somebody else? Why don't you take care of somebody else before you're taken care of? This is crazy now. You ready for crazy? Chad's always ready for crazy, because he's been there a long time. But you see, this is what crazy is. I'm gonna make sure I want a new car, I'm gonna go buy you a new car, and I'll ride my old car. I don't even know what you're talking about, preacher. You're just talking silly because you can. I know, it is crazy kind of thinking, right? But just an understanding. And I can tell you story after story, but I don't want to bore you. You see, God here in this passage, he says, is anybody rich towards God? Does anybody pursue God like they pursue wealth? You will get up every day and go to work. You will set your alarms. What time do you set them? 4? 4:30? Anybody earlier than 4? What time?
3 o'clock.
That's not normal. You will get up and go to work Monday to Friday. You will not miss a day of work. Do we pursue God like that? And you know you're not going there because you want to be with the people. Right. You're going there for your paycheck, man. Thanks, Felicia. You're going there for your paycheck. I don't want answers. This just self-reflect. Do we pursue God like we pursue money? We say we are lovers of God and not lovers of money. Are we? Do we pursue God? True riches. Or do we pursue this lie that has been pawned off to you and I, like we're a bunch of idiots, if you will, mindless, ignorant drones pursuing something that is empty and corruptible, right? Are we okay? Are we still friends? I better lighten it up a little bit. Are we lovers of God or lovers of money? There's nothing wrong with going to work. God bless your faithfulness. God bless your faithfulness. But God first, right? Are we lovers of God or lovers of money? God says, I encourage you this. He says, I encourage you to be rich towards God. To be rich towards God. Let's read another passage. Luke 16. Maybe we'll just read the first two verses. This is great, guys. I'll keep telling you it's great until you agree with me. Verses 1 and 2. It says, Jesus told his disciples, he says, once again, there was a rich man whose manager was accused of wasting his possessions. So he called him in and asked him, what is this I hear about you? Give an account of your management. We'll pause there. Give an account of your management because you cannot be manager any longer. You know, all too often when it comes to finances, more than anything helps, perhaps, we want people to give an account for their dollars. Have you been wise with the dollars that have been given you? And here this account is, you know, he was asking the manager, have you managed the money well? Sometimes you get this stinking thinking and this rotten preaching that goes out and says you don't have money because God don't trust you with money because you don't manage it well. Well, we're going to get into that. You see, and we always want an account. This manager was brought to account. How are you handling the money, as if money matters? How are you handling the money that was given to you? And then it goes on in verse 10 and 11 of that same account. This is the parable of the shrewd manager. He was the shrewd manager. You can read the whole story later. But it says here in verse 10 and 11, it says, whoever can be trusted with very little can also be trusted with much. You ever heard that one? If you are faithful with little, you'll be faithful with much, right? Yeah, sure. It says, and whoever is dishonest or unfaithful with very little will be dishonest with much. So here's the test, everybody. Here's the test. Before we go on to how to be rich, the question is, can you be trusted with riches? Amen. Can you be trusted? And some, I think most of you, I still got you on the financial aspect of it, where you're thinking about money. Can you be trusted with riches? Because the true riches that God is speaking of in the Bible and in our hearts, the true riches, God's first going to test you with something little called mammon or money. He'll test you with that. He'll test you with some gifts and some talents to see if you can really be trusted with true riches. With true riches. Can you be trusted? You say, how to be rich? Does anybody want to be rich? Yes, Lord. Sure. But can you be trusted? Can you be trusted? It's like a parent asking a child, can you be trusted with riches? And they got this bag full of money. Can you be trusted with riches? And what do we say? Yes, Dad. Yes, Mom. I can be trusted. Just give me that money, man. Yes, I can be trusted. I can be trusted. Can you be trusted? Well, if you're faithful with little, you'll be faithful with much. So I just wanted to take a few minutes with you, and I wanted to look at some Bible examples of how to manage money. Are you guys okay with that? Well, maybe look at three examples. How do you manage money then? Because Scripture says you got to be a shrewd manager. You got to manage money well. And if you can manage money well, then God will trust you with true riches. So let's see what the Bible, here we go, it's going to be a curve here. Let's see what the Bible says about riches. Can you be trusted with riches? Let's look at our first example, the poor widow, Luke 21. Here's example number one. As Jesus looked up, he saw the rich putting their gifts into the temple treasury. He also saw a poor widow put in two very small copper coins, or the two mites, if you will. Truly, I tell you, Jesus said, this poor widow has put in more than all the others. And all these people gave their gifts out of their wealth, but she, out of her poverty, she wasn't waiting to win the lotto. She gave what she didn't have. She knew she would never win the lotto, but she still gave every penny she owned. She gave out of her poverty. Give out of your poverty. Don't give out of your wealth, everybody. Give out of your poverty. Give out of your poverty. When you have nothing, give it away. And it says she gave out of her poverty, and she put in all she had to live on. And example number one. Can you be trusted? This is the first example of the Bible. Whatever you have, give it all away. What? I was snoring there. What? Give it all away. Because if you can't be trusted, now God will take you to certain degrees, like everybody, just, you know, ease up a little bit. But God will take you to wherever he wants to take you. But if, in order for God to trust you with true riches, first he's got to see if you can be trusted with untrue riches. And here's one of our examples. Give it all away. Oh, that's not shrewd. According to the Bible, it's shrewd. According to the Bible, that's wisdom. Man's wisdom. Oh, man's wisdom doesn't say that. No. No, we got this arrogant thought process in regard to money. Right? And if you don't have it, you are unwise and you don't know how to manage money. Really? 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 Jesus told this poor widow, and he used her and said she gave all that she have. She didn't count the cost. She didn't anticipate a risk. She didn't, we talked about Wednesday, she didn't even think there was a risk involved to give everything she had, knowing that she had no meal for tomorrow. Amen. She didn't even consider the risk. I don't know. I just want to change the way we think. Your actions is up to you and God. Can you listen to me if I tell you that your actions are between you and God, and just maybe you'll entertain maybe God allowing to change the way you think about money, and truly set us free, everybody.
truly set us free. You see, can you be trusted with true riches? Here's our example number one. She gave it all away. She gave it all away. All right, let's get some more proof from the Bible. Let's look at Luke 18, 18 to 23. And we looked at a poor widow. Why don't we look at a rich young man then? Let's look at a rich young man instead of a poor widow. I'll tell you why she's a poor widow. She gave all her money away. Here we go. Let's look at the rich young man. Okay. Okay, then look at this other philosophy. Let's see if this one works. A certain ruler asked him, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" You guys know this one. Jesus said to him, "Why do you call me good?" Come on, you. "Why do you call me good?" Jesus answered, "No one is good except God alone. You know the commandments. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not murder. You shall not steal. You shall not give false testimony. Honor your father and mother." All the fathers and mothers say, "Amen." Good. And then the rich young man, he said, all these I have kept since I was a boy," he said. When Jesus heard this, he said to him, "You still lack one thing. Sell everything you have and give it to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come and follow me." When he heard this, he became very sad because he was very wealthy. Sometimes you hear a message like this, and if you're honest with me, if you're willing to stay awake and listen to the rest of the message, you see, we would also become very sad because we think we have a certain amount of something and we're not so willing to let go of a certain lifestyle that we live, right? Anybody in the house today? Yeah. You see, this rich young ruler went away very sad because he had much wealth. The second example we have in the Bible, can you be trusted with true riches? He told this rich young man, he said, "Why don't you sell everything that you have?" And what did he say? "Give it to the poor," something like that. "And give it to the poor." According to mankind and the philosophies of the day, that's not wisdom, that's foolishness. Anybody want to say? No one wants to say. Yeah, all right. Yeah. According to the way we do, let me do my calculations here. According to my 20-year plan here, let's see. If you give everything away, you got no plan at all, man. It's just a matter of God changing the way we think. If he changes the way we think, he changes our world.
Amen.
Note this. We said it on Wednesday. Maybe I'll give you a word of comfort, okay? I'll give you a word of comfort. This rich man would have continued to stay rich because God called him to be rich for the purpose of giving wealth away. If he sold all that he had and gave it to the poor, I am almost certain that God would have doubled his wealth so he could sell it again and give it to the poor, and then tripled his wealth so he could sell it. I believe that's how God operates. He causes the rich to be rich for the purpose to give. Anybody want to say amen to that?
Amen.
You could never deplete yourself in God. God can never be depleted. It's just a matter of you want to know how to be rich? Be self-emptying. Empty yourself continually, and God will fill you up again and again and again. You think you're to the top? Give it all away and start all over again, right? Yeah, these are some of the spiritual truths. How to be rich, and then can you be trusted with riches? Can you be trusted with riches? And what I'm really hoping is that it sets you free. I hope it sets you free. Because you and I both know that sometimes the dollars are tight, and you want to do good things, and you want to help. Some of you don't want the money necessarily for yourself. Some of you wish you had the money for your children and for your grandchildren. Can anybody say amen? Can any honest parents out there say something like that? Some of you want to have the money to help your neighbor. Some of you would like to be benevolent in giving, right? But what lies to us not necessarily is our pocketbook. It's our thought processes that says, I can't. I got this coming up tomorrow, and I got this coming up next week, and I'm preparing for that. Not always, everybody, but sometimes. Sometimes there's money in your pocket, and you say no, because if you give that money, then and I know some of you have no more money. But I want to teach you how to be rich. Give it away. Expecting nothing in return.
Amen.
You're not doing it because you want God to double it tomorrow, right? How many years, everybody, did we grow up in church giving because we believed, "Give and it shall be given back to you. I'm going to give this 10, I'm going to get 100.
Amen.
Nothing godly about that, amen.
Right.
Nothing godly about that. Nothing godly about that.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah, and you see how to be rich. And God is going to teach us how to be rich. That was example number two. Let's look at a third example, in Luke chapter 6. I forget what this one is, but let us read it together. In Luke 6, thank you, brother. In verses 27 through 28, it says, "But to you who are listening, I say." Okay, this is great because it talks about more than wealth here. It says, "Love your enemies. Love your enemies. Do good to those who hate you. Bless those who curse you." How are we doing so far? Well, get back to the money, preacher. Forget about this. Now you want to get back to the money, right? Just get back to the money. "I say, love your enemies, preacher. Bless those who curse you." Not God get them, not curse them back. Bless those who curse you. "How about those who mistreat you? What do you do?" Well, I'll tell them what I'll do. Pray for those who mistreat you. Amen. Pray for those. I want you to see that our thinking does need to be changed. Because we're all about self-preservation. And little do we know, when I step on you, I step on me. Right? Because we are one. So pray for those who mistreat you. You want me to go on, Brother Keith? No, go ahead, brother. Good, but thank you. You're a good man, brother. "Give to everyone who asks you." How about that? Oh, I don't know. You better be some. Phil, you better come up and preach about some disclaimers to that one. Okay, I don't know about that. God guide you. "Give to everyone who asked." I don't know, no disclaimer. "And if anyone takes what belongs to you, then what?" Then what? Why are you pointing at me? Then what? If you take what belongs to me, Phil? Then what? Then what? We are talking about how to be rich here, right? You are way off the trail, brother. You have no idea how to be rich. That's what Phil told me on the way up here. He says, you don't know. "If anyone takes what belongs to you," the wrath of God. No, it should be the wrath of God if I were the writer. "Do not demand it back." Amen. "But it was yours." You know what I think? Some of you know what I think and you don't like it. Sometimes I believe that God gives you things so people can steal something from you. I knew you were crazy. I knew it. Now I am justified not listening to you, not listening to a word you say. I'm justified. Wow. Thank God you had something worth stealing. Some of you have nothing worth stealing. And I pray. Let's pray. Father, give him something worth stealing and then send the thief to steal it. But don't we get twisted with our thinking? And when you attach religion to it, we got God on our sides. God's going to kill you for taking from me. But if anyone takes what belongs to you, don't demand it back. Okay, brother. "If you lend to those from whom you expect repayment, what credit is that to you? Even sinners lend to sinners." And sinners, really, it's just unbelievers. It's any one of us who don't believe. "Even sinners lend to sinners, expecting to be repaid in full." These are just basic truths. There's nothing in depth here. And then it goes on. It says, "But love your enemies. Do good to them. Lend to them without expecting to get anything back. Then God can trust you." How to be rich. Then God can trust you. "Then your reward will be great. And you will be children," how about this? "Then you will be children of the Most High." There's nothing greater than that. There's nothing greater than that. Amen. Amen. Because he is kind to the ungrateful. Sometimes that one's not easy. He was kind to the ungrateful. Not only was he kind to the ungrateful, what's that next word? Really? 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 He was kind to the wicked. He was kind to the wicked. Interesting. Was there anything else, brother? That's all you got, huh? He's like, there was, but that's enough. That's enough. He's stricken back there. He's stricken. No more. Preacher. I cannot bear to put another verse up. Why don't we all turn around and look at our brother Keith? Everybody, brother Keith. He's smitten back there. Just. Can you be trusted with true wealth? God says, if you're faithful with little, which is dollars and cents, you'll be faithful with true riches. And I want us to end with a thought or two. First of all, God is not looking to raise your standard of living. It's a little quaint, but God is looking to raise your standard of giving.
Amen.
He's not looking to raise your standard of living.
Amen.
Amen. And it's okay in our natural selves. We all want to live comfortably, but that's not, God is looking to raise, that's not like you won't live comfortably. It's okay. But comfortable is different for everybody. He wants to change your standard of giving. He wants you to be of a generous heart.
That's right.
It's the heart of God. The heart of God just empties himself. To who? To the wicked, to the unrighteous, to the ungrateful, to you, to me. How many times has God forgiven me when I didn't even ask for it? How about you? How many times was he good to me? How many times, come on, if you want to be honest, and anybody want to be honest today, how many times has God given me money when he knew I was going to spend it on something no good? Anybody ever spend their money on something they should not have? Come on now.
Amen.
You know who gave you that money? God.
Amen.
God gave you that money. He gave you that money knowing darn well I was going straight to burp, 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 burp. He was good to the wicked, and he was good to the ungrateful, because eventually he'd have my heart, and he knew he'd have my heart. Because he'll get your heart, which is more valuable than anything else. Right? Our God is so great, we don't understand how great he is. He's so loving and kind and compassionate. We don't understand. We don't understand how much he loves us. Yeah. You know, let me end with another thought or two, and this one really struck me. Any of you who know how the church began back in 2,000 years ago, the church began where everybody would take their money or possessions, and if they had possessions, they would sell possessions. And I don't want you to get caught up in the physical aspects of this. They would take their possessions, sell them, and lay them at the apostles' feet. Has anyone ever heard of that one? And then the apostles would distribute it among the needy. You know what I don't see today? They didn't lay all their possessions at the apostles' feet so the apostles could have it. Or so the apostles could be rich. The apostles should have been the poorest of them all. And the only reason why any minister of God should be given anything is for the purpose to give it away. And if you consider yourself to be a godly person, a lover of God, and if I may, I consider you to be a lover of God, then realize that any time that God has blessed you, there's purpose for it. And it's to give away. God will take care of your needs. You know God will take care. Does everybody know that?
Yes.
Does everybody know that he loves you? He'll take care of you. But why don't you see how God wants to use you? It was never for you and I to be rich. It was never for the apostles to be rich. It was never for the apostles to accumulate anything in banks and storehouses and build bigger barns. It was to give away. We're all one. We're all equal. I think the apostles, Pastor Phil, I think we should be the poorest of them all, man. And there's nobody more giving in my life than my brother Philip. You know what giving does? I'll tell you, my brother Phil, giving takes away your shame. My brother has taken away my shame time and time again because he gave me. He took away my shame. He gave me dollars? No, he didn't. He took away my shame. Anybody understand that?
Amen.
Why do you think God has blessed you? How to be rich. Let me add two words at the end. Towards God. Can you be trusted with true riches. Because the true riches is the kingdom of heaven. Can you be trusted? I got to step down. Can you be trusted with true riches? Because the true riches is the kingdom of heaven. If God gives you the kingdom, will you give it out freely? If God gives you a revelation, will you give out the love freely? Will you give away forgiveness? Will you be kind to your enemies? Will you bless those who curse you? Can God trust you? That's good yeses, brother. Can God trust you with true riches? We all want to be rich. Can he trust you with it? Because if he gives you the kingdom, he's got to make sure you're going to give it away. Because Jesus had the kingdom and he became nothing to give it away. He gave it away. He took shame so you could have glory. He took nakedness so you could be clothed. God did that. God Almighty. God became poor and weak and naked and sick and dying. God, he amassed nothing for himself. He emptied himself entirely. Why? For you. Amen. For you. For you. Can you be trusted with true riches? Can you be trusted? Because God wants to give you the kingdom, but he wants to give it to you to give it away. No strings attached. Sometimes we act as if we're the possessors of the kingdom, and I will give you kindness if you deserve it, and I will give you love if you deserve it, because sometimes I think you deserve hell. Well, then you don't deserve the kingdom yourself. I'm sorry, you don't deserve the kingdom yourself. We hold back love and forgiveness and kindness. Well, then you have no right to that. Can you be trusted with it? Can you be trusted with it? See, how to be rich? God wants to give you the kingdom. By the examples of the Bible, this is what he wants you to do with the kingdom. Freely you have received, freely give. Do not put a prayer, a disclaimer, anything on the gifts of heaven. You give forgiveness. They don't have to ask for it. They don't have to pray for it. It's a gift. It's a gift. They don't have to ask for love or be worthy of it. Give it to them. Give it to them. Give away the kingdom of heaven. Because you don't even know how rich you are. Can I get a witness? Amen. Amen. That's good. Sister Trick, team, where are you, team? Tiger Lou, Carlos, Brian, Randy. Everybody, we need a savior. All right. Why don't we stand up for a moment or two, everybody? Praise the Lord. All right, man.
I could have taught me how to be rich. And even as I opened up that bulletin, I even thought to myself, I said, he's the only one that can even preach this message. You know, he didn't study for a couple hours this week to preach that. He's lived it. Okay? My brother has lived it. And if that is the true riches, it's the riches that he talked about. That is the true rich man. And yes, we are rich.
Amen.
We are rich in Christ. These are the true riches. You know, it was one of those passages, I think it was 18, where it says, as you go on, it says that it's easier for the camel to enter in through the eye of the needle than for the rich man to enter into the kingdom. And you know why? Because the stupid, slow-footed camel will easily take off the treasure off its back so he can get into the kingdom. He don't care about the gold and the silver. He just wants to go into the kingdom.
Amen.
Now, he didn't say the rich man couldn't get in. He just said it was easier for the camel to do it.
Right.
The rich man just got to do the same thing and just drop it so he can get into the kingdom of God.
Mm.
Amen?
Mm. Amen?
These are the riches, church.
Mm.
It's real easy. All you got to do is drop the load and then you can get in. Amen?
Amen.
And we go before our Father.
Amen.
Heavenly Father, we do thank you for this day, Lord God. We thank you for the word of truth that was spoken, Lord God. Pray, Lord God, that you'll just let us meditate on this day, Lord God, and allow it to change us and change our heart, Lord, and know what the true riches are, the riches that you have given to us, Lord, that we are the rich man in the earth, Lord God, and that we will be able to hand it out. So, Lord, we say thank you for these opportunities that you provide in our life, that we have the ability to hand it out, Lord, that you've trusted us with this treasure, Lord God, and we get to hand it out, Lord God, and experience your joy and your goodness in life, Lord. We thank you for this day, Lord God. We thank you for the truth. We hold on to it. We know it is power, Lord. We know it is might, Lord God. And we say this day, Lord, we are the rich man in the earth. We'll go out and hand it out, Lord. And everybody say,
amen. Amen.
Could this be?